The year is 1893, and Edvard Munch, the Norwegian painter, creates this masterpiece. Ladies and gentlemen, how many of you have seen this painting before? Raise your hands. It's a painting that gives a sense of eeriness, of strangeness, of a stick-like figure looking in the distance, covering its head and screaming. This is a painting of profound insight because it shows the complexity of the human emotions, of an underlying rich tapestry. It is also a painting that reminds us about the expression of humans and not the physical reality as it's drawn. And these distorted perspectives, these swirls and twirls, gives us the further sense of eeriness. We can appreciate the sky and the earth merging together, combining with that angst. And of course, color is an emotion, is a symbol, the orange with a tinge of red, further accentuating the sense. Vincent van Gogh, another important painter, Dutch impressionist. Van Gogh suffered severely with mental illness for most of his life, unfortunately, tragically, killing himself at the age of 37 due to suicide. The painting that you see on the right side is Van Gogh after having cut his left ear with a razor in December of 1888. And during that time, he shows this beautiful painting of himself, a stoic expression in his eyes, a sense of commitment of the artist, and the resilience that it shows. And of course, we have seen the Starry Night, one of the marvels of Western art history, the beauty of the cosmos within and within and without. And it's important to think about how it is that mental illness shows itself in pictures and how people relate to that experience. One final example is Lewis William Wayne. He's an English artist that anthropomorphizes cats and kittens in an allegory of the human experience. You can appreciate alcohol, hard liquor, smoking, a communal sense of gathering, similar to humans, highlighting a more profound experience of addiction, of the psychological underpinnings behind that experience. We can appreciate that clearly in these paintings. Art is a vehicle for mental states. And as we can appreciate, and as my story has shared, the narration of self-discovery through stories. It began with visual elements, going to museums, seeing painters and artists, and it convened with patients and their personal stories, the art of narrative itself. I've always been interested in what people have to offer, what they believe, and what they can share, of how I can transform myself and the world around me. And I've been very privileged to be at McGill University, experiencing really wonderful mentors and colleagues, people I can learn from, and of course, the patients themselves. So as we can see through the visual and the verbal aspects of storytelling, there's elements of empathy, there's elements of compassion, of humanity that are deeply rich within these things. And that art provides us with the psychological perils, with the depiction of what these mental struggles are, so that we too can understand it. There's another side as well to art history and to the history of psychiatry itself. As we look at the evolution of psychiatry, as we look at the sense of people initially, in prehistoric ages, thinking of demons residing within us and having to have them exit the body, to a further advancement later on where people we're in asylums, but more in a custodian feature before the birth and compassion of psychiatry really blossomed. It's important for us to think about how we have gotten to the stage of biological psychiatry, that correlations between genetics, neural states, helps us understanding symptomatology of patients and what we can learn from that experiences. There's another element to this as well, that the stories of mental illness are unique to the patients alone, that those stories are sacred and protected, and that they help us in understanding and contextualizing things, in a role to self-discovery, in a role of understanding, in a role of us crafting our own journeys. And I will talk to you about many examples of this within this presentation. There's another element as well, that there are inner demons within, that there are struggles, problems, that we cannot verbalize, but they exist and they are real. And through this cultivation of a therapeutic expression, whether it be through people, whether it be through art, whether it be through other elements, we can connect to something far greater, far deeper. The experience that I'm about to share with you, the four clinical vignettes, require a certain preface. As a medical learner, I've been very privileged to work with very seasoned physicians, psychiatrists with decades of experience, seeing very complex stories of patients. And it's really important for me to respect the dignity and the humanity of these people, the struggles they face to ensure that their identities are protected. The other element to also talk about is a diagnosis of psychiatry takes further experiences, many, many years of insight, in order to clarify and crystallize. So I don't want to give a sense that these are within a few minutes of a TEDx talk, but the underlying images are, I think, were of very importance. And of course, these are sensitive mental health narratives, so embrace yourself for some serious stories. The first case I would like to express to you is a gentleman, a middle-aged gentleman, that comes to the emergency room, who hears distorted whispers, auditory and visual hallucinations, of certain things that are going to harm him. And he's very frightened by these things. He lives in a constant state of fear. And he comes to the emergency room department to get help. Because when he doesn't get help, he gets dissociated. His body dissociates from reality as a protective mechanism, as a coping strategy. Very profound experience that I'm very grateful for, that in encountering stories of this level of complexity, the first element is building a visual trust with people, of understanding them, of what their story is about. And of course, becoming an ally to the individual, so that they can be on the same side of that team, and a sense of grounding presence. The reflections are immense. The first thing that I can think about is the phenomenology of the first-person experience. How is it possible that two different people look at reality, but they have vastly different experiences of what they perceive reality to be? And of course, the intersection of psychiatry is the mind and the body relationship, a synergistic organic unity. And you can appreciate in the image of Lewis Wayne again, himself speculated to be suffering from schizophrenia. You can appreciate the cat, the object, very clearly demarcated. And as his illness progresses, the object and the background become merged into these patterns, very vivid colors. This is the reality that we can get a glimpse of, the suffering of these people and the resilience behind them. The second experience I wish to share with you is a young lady. She comes to the emergency room feeling very depressed, low mood, poor concentration, poor appetite, following the breakdown of a very meaningful relationship to her. And she comes in and she talks to the team, and she mentions the sense of hopelessness and not wanting to be there anymore. What can you do in that circumstance? What are the thoughts that you think about? The safety of the person, the sense that they belong somewhere, is by far the most important in this situation. And it was very humbling to see the story of this young lady, of how she felt traumatized, and the compassion that comes with it. And the compassion itself is a root of Latin, to suffer with, to take these experiences and transmogrify ourselves. The reflections here, which is unique to all of us, whether or not we are affiliated with psychiatry, is that there's a sense of vulnerability, humanity, that the fragility of existence requires us to appreciate the dignity and the respect that we have for people. That emotional vulnerability is beyond words. There are pictures of worlds, worlds that matter, stories that matter. And an amplifying hope and a sense of grounding, we can do what we can in mitigating this to the best of our abilities. And of course, trust as a currency of truth. Trust is the foundation that nations bind to each other, that love is built, that emotions carry that sense of network. The third case I wish to share with you is a case of a manic bipolar disorder. A young gentleman that comes to the ER with many, many nights that he has not slept, spurs of creativity, of ideas, blossoming, not letting him to eat or to sleep. His wife is very concerned. His wife comments that he has plunged into a profound sense of depression just a few weeks ago, and that these highs and lows of mood, of affect, have an oscillatory system. They go up and down, and they're unpredictable, and has severely impaired his life and daily living. It's important in this case that we take the patient and their family as a collaborative unity, that we understand their struggles, that we understand what they are coming from, so we can be a part of that picture. And it really is a humbling miracle that every day of our lives, whether we're medical learners or seasoned physicians, we can find those junctions and those stories. From this encounter, I can offer you a number of insights, that meaningful conversations really decode complex emotions, and that in doing so, they unveil beautiful parts about the person, revealing something pure about the individuality of that person. And that personal growth is a process through the therapeutic relationship between the patient, between the physician, between the student. I refer back again to Van Gogh to see the utter agony of a gentleman who's curling in the chair, covering his face for a sense of shielding, a sense of guarding. And another photo of Van Gogh's physician, Dr. Gaucher, his eyes pensive, full of sorrow, a sorrow that still captures us in 2024, given that it was drawn in 1890. The final case I wish to share with you is a girl with anorexia nervosa, an eating disorder. She comes in with a serious concern that every measure of her caloric intake is measured, that the mirror has become her harshest critic, that the body image that she believes psychologically has severely impacted her, specific weight that has to be maintained, specific routines that have to be kept, and the parents are very concerned. And it is important in this situation to not be judgmental, to understand these experiences to the best of our ability, so that we can relate to something about that. And the body image is the cultivation of those ideas in conjunction with each other. Meaning making and healing is a reflection I found through this experience, that the language of medicine is not just words, medication, and therapy, that there's something beyond that transformative journey that we have a privilege to be a part of and to witness and to learn from. And that hope is not just a word, it's not an idea, it's a world, it's a healing force, that possibilities can only exist if there is a glimmer of something. And these cases beautifully illustrate the resilience it takes to share stories, to have the courage to be present. We talked about images and art. We talked about stories of patients. We talked about how these relate to us. The biggest takeaway of this talk is a call to action. That if you find people, friends, colleagues, family members, people that are having difficulty, the most important step is to suggest for them to come and get professional help. And there's no stigmas associated with that. Help is a sign of hope, and it is important for us to be able to break those silences within the life that we live. And that through these vulnerabilities and reception, new worlds emerge. The biggest story of inspiration for me are all of these patients I have seen and for the privilege of being around. And they are warriors to me. They are people who go through very difficult times, very difficult journeys. And they're still willing to try. There's a courage behind the hope, whether the hope is immediately obvious or is not. And that the inner demons within all of us can only be cultivated through a sense of order, and that order is within, and it can be cultivated. Thank you very much.